What's going on, Aces? Welcome back to the channel. Kurt Franklin has put out a new documentary which chronicles while working on his new album titled Father's Day. He located his real biological dad after decades of searching. So when Kurt Franklin began working on a new album earlier this year, the Grammy-winning musician had no idea what was in store. So he said that, you know, he has been, and I'm sure like myself and most of you have grown up on Kurt Franklin and the family's music. He's the best-selling gospel artist in history, and he absolutely deserves it. You know, he has an ear for music. He has an ear for talent. Tamla Mann has been with him for decades. And I can say that this documentary was so vulnerable and so beautiful, but we got to see a side of Kurt that, you know, was very private and very intimate. And I really commend him for being so open and transparent with this journey. He says, quote, "This is the first time I've had a behind the scenes videographer capturing content for the making of a project." He's working on his 13th album. He said, "I recorded the first song in March and then in April, and everything shifted and became something that I could have never planned for." And the cameras captured beautiful bonding between not only Kirk and his real biological father, pictured here, Mr. Hubbard recovered, but also, you know, him bonding with his son, Kerryon, who he hadn't seen for years. And if you guys remember, they had a public falling out where Kurt was really angry at him. And, you know, Kerryon released the audio of his dad basically cussing him out. So they hadn't, you know, really talked for years as well, but they got a chance to reconcile. And the whole thing was just extremely beautiful. He compiled the footage of these events in a short documentary. It's only half an hour. I'm going to link it in my description box so you guys can see it. But his album comes out on, you know, October 6th, titled Father's Day. Please be sure to you know, to cop it, to buy it, to support him. Because this journey was just like mind-blowing. So he says, "My life before I had a career was horrific." He says that before, you know, orchestrating decades of hits like Revolution, whoop, whoop, which is one of my favorite gospel songs, and, you know, Wanna Be Happy. I'm a Melodies from Heaven girl. You know, Rain Down on Me, when he, you know, splits the choir into like the soprano, alto and tenor, that, you know, I love it. I love Kirk's ear. I think that, you know, him having like the Clark sisters there during the documentary, I love his ear for music. He said that he actually got that when, you know, Miss Gertrude adopted him when she was 64 years old. She didn't have children. He was 4. And he said that, you know, he was raised pretty much in isolation, like no cousins, no siblings. He said it was a really difficult childhood, knowing that he saw his birth parents or his birth mother and the man that he thought was his father a few times a year. He said that typically when kids are adopted, their birth parents don't pop in and out of their life so that scar can heal. He said, but every time he saw them and then they would leave, he would wonder why he wasn't worthy or valuable enough for them to take, you know, take him with them, and he was never able to heal. He said, but the one, I guess, you know, silver lining in that dark cloud was that piano at the front of the house. And he said that that's where he met God, and that's where his love for music really began. And that was his solace in being so isolated, because he, you know, had a really difficult time at school, and he had a really hard time growing up, just feeling unwanted, unloved. And so he says, quote, "I lived being bullied as a kid. I had a learning disorder. I failed out of high school. I got a young lady pregnant when I was 17, and the church crucified me for it. He says, it's like I never had anybody take up for me or who had my back. And the woman who adopted him, Miss Gertrude, she was a 64-year-old widow. She did the best she could when I was young. She got on government aid and would find money to pay for my piano lessons. But by 12 or 13, I felt abandoned by her because I could tell that I became more of an irritant. I wanted to date and go out, and I always felt like I was inconveniencing her. It just added to the feeling of displacement. So when Kirk was 6 years old, he was introduced to Amanda, his biological mother. And here we have Miss Jones, that's his mother. She said that he was his biological father. He says, I didn't see him again until I was 13. And then he started showing up at concerts after my first album came out. And I was angry at the fact that I didn't have a father, and he would dare show up once my life seemed, you know, to have some sense of order. Same for my biological mother, because he hadn't seen her for years before this documentary came out. He said it was very traumatic for me. And that was the running theme throughout the entire documentary, was him being very intentional about setting boundaries, right? Like when he went to his aunt's house, Aunt Sandra, she was like, boy, get out this truck. He said, you know, first I need you to sign a press release. He's like, but I need to stay here until my biological mom shows up. But pretty much, I need space for me. And I'm so glad that he did that, right? Because as a 53-year-old, he said, you know, I'm being treated like I'm 10 years old. He's like, but I can feel, I can resonate with that, you know, small 10-year-old boy. And so they took a DNA test, right? And the results were 99.9999% match for paternity from Mr. Richard Hubbard. And he says, you know, to live over half a century with somebody who lived in the same city as you, my goodness. He said he was still grappling with the news. He said, I suffered so much as a young man without guidance. I suffered with love and intimacy, faith, identity. He said, and to know that that answer was only less than 10 minutes away, it's heartbreaking, man. And his mom, her response is really what gutted me, because you could tell that she was dealing with her own trauma, right? Like Kirk didn't blame, you know, Mr. Rich Hubbard. You know, he says that he was a kid when Kirk was born, only 14 or 15. He said he never even knew that he had a son. And so, you know, his mom, she could not connect with the fact, like she actually, you know, denied the fact that Richard Hubbard was Kirk's father. And so she demanded a second test with her being present, right? So they obliged her. They did the second test. And of course, again, the results came back 99.999% paternity that matched with Rich Hubbard. And so, you know, she unfortunately continued on in her denial. And Kurt said, you know, if you can't give me this, then I don't know where we can go in our relationship. And I respect him for that. It's difficult, but she was so, you know, I guess, deep in her own trauma and denial that she would not have been emotionally available for Kirk in the way that he needed her. But what he did was he reconnected here with his own son, Carrion, which was beautiful. It was a beautiful moment. You know, he was intentional about, you know, stroking his face, because he said that he had to let him know that his grandfather, his biological grandfather, was still alive. Because if you remember, the man that he thought was his father, he had buried years ago. He said he had made peace with that. He spent his whole life hating this man that wasn't even his father. But it had been years since he'd spoken with his own son as well. And he said the reason why he titled his album Father's Day was it was not only connecting with his own biological father, but as a father, reconnecting with his son. And then, you know, that relationship with his heavenly father being restored as well, or I shouldn't say restored, but rejuvenated in a sense. And so he says, quote, "My son is a beautiful soul. There are parts of his life that are his to share, and I'm very proud that I'm seeing him in his own way." He says he is beginning to reveal and testify to his own struggles, his own battles with certain things that have at times cost him. And I know that many Black men struggle with these things. As he continues to get help and healing, he's going to help so many. He has me and now his grandfather that will be there to help anyway. And I think that that's so beautiful. He says, "I have fathered out of fear of the majority of my parenting life because of what I experienced." And, you know, he says, you know, "I don't want to let my kids feel that type of pain." But he said, "I had to learn that my children have been the best part of my life." And I feel like that's such a beautiful sentiment. So I want you guys to, you know, support Kurt Franklin, support the album, go watch the documentary. It's beautiful. It's life-changing. You know, it brought me to tears. You guys can tell I'm getting choked up talking about it, because a lot of Kirk's upbringing, unfortunately, I can resonate with personally. But I'm really grateful that he was able to be so open and transparent. You know, he was talking about how he had his therapist on speed dial, and I'm like, yes, Kurt. You know, therapy is crucial. So you guys go support him. Let me know in the comments what you think about the documentary. Like I said, it's only half an hour and so good. I'll link it. And I want you guys to watch it, and then I want to hear from you. Please be sure to like, share, and subscribe if you haven't done so already, and I will talk to you later. Take care, Aces. Bye.